So hi everyone, I just wanted to make a recorded presentation so it may help you understand better what's the aim of this project. So again, the title of our project is Multiphysics Constrained Deep Learning Neural Network, right? So as I may, maybe if you've already checked the presentation, is we are not aiming at designing a deep learning neural network that's based on training, either experimental or numerical. No, we are planning to develop a novel DLNN, which is based on physics constraint. So it's constrained by the partial differential equation. All right. So in general, of course, we have the standard numerical tools that we use to simulate any multiphysics process, like COMSOL, for example, or Abacus, or Placemo that we used in our APCRC project, right? Different numerical tools that can simulate the multiphysics process, all right? So, but of course, these tools are tedious. They are very time-consuming. They take very long time to simulate. So it will not be practical to create a digital twin. So if we are able to develop a DLNN code that understands the multiphysics process, that does not need experimental data to train itself and to understand the process, right? And we can program this on a chip. And this chip is linked to a group of sensors that measure, for example, the plasma chemistry or the polymer surface characteristics, right? Then the chip itself can send commands to the input, to the gas flow, to the voltage, all right? Voltage magnitude, for example, the voltage frequency that are usually used to produce cold plasma, to control the plasma chemistry, so you can have better surface, polymer surface characteristics. Yes, the process, of course, here is a standard one, a simple one, right? It has this advantages which I will present later, but of course it can be expanded and applied on different multiphysics manufacturing techniques, like for example our additive manufacturing of composites, all right? It can be applied also there, right? So just in general, why deep learning neural network, all right? And why are we using in this case? So deep learning neural network, again, it shows new promises for surrogate modeling due to its capability of handling strong nonlinearity and high dimensional ability, which again, of course, we have in this case very highly nonlinear problem related to the plasma chemistry itself or even the chemical reaction at the polymer surface. And that's why we need deep learning. As I mentioned a couple of minutes ago, the physics constrained DLNN will not require any training, all right, at all, zero training. Instead, it uses the partial differential equation itself, so it tries to minimize the partial differential equations. So in general, in the neural network, how it works, it has input and output, and it tries to minimize some function, which usually the difference between experimental and the output, for example. Try to minimize it. And that's why it needs training, a lot of training data, so can it train itself to find the neuron constants within the neural network and layers and stuff like that. But instead of just minimizing the experimental and numerical, we're going to minimize the residuals of the partial differential equations. So this paper over here, you can go, if you want to check more details about this paper, they applied on Navier-Stokes equation. All right. So it's done already on Navier-Stokes equation. It has, of course, disadvantages of saying it takes very long time to be trained, which is one of the points we'll try to improve in this project. All right. So if all it does, it minimizes, for example, the residual of the mass continuity and the continuity of the momentum. They try to minimize these residuals, and it uses the boundary conditions and initial conditions to train itself. So you can ask, all right, but partial differential equations has partial differential terms, how they are calculated. They are not calculated using finite difference, all right? They are calculated using something called AD, automatic differentiation, which at the code level or symbol level. So everything is done within the neural network, does not require any finite difference, no finite element to train itself, to, for example, in this paper, to approximate or model Navier-Stokes equation. Digital twin, as again, I just mentioned again 5-10 minutes ago, it's mainly used to create a digital twin of a process. So it can be used online, all right, online. Why? It can self-tune itself or give us intelligent recommendations what to do to improve product quality. And no need then for pre-numerical simulation. Pre-numerical simulation takes very long time, hours or days, all right, to optimize or of course, we don't need to understand the physics. In this case, the main function of the digital twin, mainly only the self-tuning, all right, and intelligent recommendation. It reduces risk, improve production, it lower, of course, maintenance costs, all right? So atmospheric pressure plasma treatment, the one actually will be the main focus or the main application of this DLNN development. What's the objective? To alter the surface physical and chemical properties without affecting the bulk itself. So by engineering, improve biocompatibility, for example, adhesion, the surface properties like, for example, friction, right? In aerospace, it's mainly improve bonding strength between polymer and metals or polymers and fibers, all right? So, of course, there are limitations of this process. The plasma process surface lack uniformity, so it's not uniform, which it can be improved through the self-tuning of the digital twin. The gas ionization efficiency can decrease the power efficiency more than tenfold, depending on the carrier plasma and substrate. Again, self-tuning can help in that. Force can lead to polymer degradation if the plasma is too powerful, the density of the ions are too high, then it can lead to polymer degradation, all right? When we talk about modeling of atmospheric pressure plasma treatment, there are two chemical events at the surface. One is called physical adsorption, which is weak, and one is called irreversible adsorption, which is chemical and which is very strong, all right? This one is very, very strong, all right? So again, different surface modifications called ideal modification of the plasma, functionalized polymer, something like that. Too strong modification, intense plasma, so it can lead to surface functionalization, and it also can lead to polymer degradation. All right, and different example regarding adhesion or polymer etching. All right. So when I think. But again, it's up to you if you think different. We should focus in this project on surface functionalization, right? Because we cannot just do everything. The project is really very, very challenging, and we do not want to make it even more challenging. So I recommend that we focus on surface functionalization, all right? That will be the main target of this, or the main application. Sorry, not target, the main application of this project, all right? The target is DLNN, multi-physics, physics constrained, does not need any training requirement, and to program it on a chip, all right? The aim of the surface modification, as you already know, to introduce functional groups to the surface. The process is called as plasma, again, the process is called as plasma gas-specific functionalization of polymer surfaces. So each gas, right, will produce different functional group, right, depending again what exactly this polymer will be adhere to, what fibers, carbon fibers, glass fibers, metal, again depending on the application itself. The coating of the surface of the polymer again is the deposition of very thin layers of plasma polymer which carry functional groups in their structures, right? I give two books here, which I use as two references, but I'm sure you are sure aware of them. But again, it can help us in the literature review section of each work package. All right. So atmospheric pressure plasma, the model itself. All right. So here, just again, I'm just listing the equations that are used to model the plasma chemistry, which again function of the densities of the ions. For example, is there negative or positive ions, right? The production rate and loss rate of these ions when electrons attached or detached to them, all right? So became more ionized or lower ionized or neutral, became an atom, right? The diffusion parameter, the mobility of the parameters, which again, usually calculated by using another software. called Plus G Plus, right? It's another software that can calculate the mobility and diffusion of ions and electrons as function of electric field. All right. Again, just listing more equation, especially the equation here that is used to model the electron density, right, and the electron diffusion as function of applied electron field. Again, just the software I just mentioned, which is again a free code that we can use to calculate, to help us to calculate the diffusion and the mobility parameters. And how these equations has to be coupled with what we call Poisson equation, all right? So we can again estimate the densities of the electron, densities of the negative ions, positive ions, and of course estimate the electric field and the temperature. The temperature of each species, all right? Because it's non-equilibrium, so each species will have its own temperature. Right. Of course, there is an open source code called Placemo, right, which we can get from Eindhoven University in Netherlands, which we can obtain its numerical code, but it can help us to train or to validate our DLNN code before without doing experimental at AMBER. So it can help us initially using this code. All right. The second model, which is the plasma polymer interactions, the second model that we require to develop. So there are two approaches to modeling of surface kinetics in reactive plasmas, right? There are deterministic approach and the kinematic Monte Carlo approach. This one is average, right? This one is average. And of course, it can be linked to Placemo. This one is not average. It's more demanding computationally, but exact, bridging the gap between simulations on atomic and macroscopic scales. So if you use molecular dynamics only, you will have the problem of time scale limitations, nanoscale. And of course, it's not possible to stretch that to seconds or minutes. It's almost impossible. And that's where came in the kinematic Monte Carlo approach, right? To help in this, to bridge the gap between atomic and macroscopic scale. All right. So the aim of the modeling is to need to predict how materials are modified under plasma exposure, again, etching, deposition, surface functionalization, and also to predict the reaction probabilities for the plasma species at polymer surface. So how the polymer surface is changing, it's changing the plasma chemistry itself, which is also very important because it may affect the next area. How the next area of the polymer will be functionalized, because again, based on the effect on the plasma itself, all right? Just when we talk about modeling of plasma surface interactions, all right, we need to talk about adsorption. I give some definition of each one here. I'm gonna just read it for you, all right? And desorption, which is opposite, of course, to each other. Diffusion, moving from higher concentration to lower concentration, and reactions at the surface itself, like bonding and cross-linking, all right? Then I talked in the presentations about deterministic models, right? What exactly they do, what exactly the objective of the deterministic models, all right? Mainly to estimate the fractional coverage of different types of adsorptions, such itself. Which one is adsorption, or which one is chemical sorption, stuff like that, all right? So deterministic models are not always accurate. Why? Why they are not always accurate? Because several simplifying assumptions are done to them. For example, a homogeneous distribution of surface species is assumed. Deterministic approach fails when the fluctuations of the number of particles become important. It's another shortcoming when we use the deterministic models. All right. So again, just what I already introduced earlier, the difference between physical adsorption and irreversible adsorptions, difference between each, one is weak and one is chemical and it's irreversible, all right? The different reactions at the surface which are modeled in the deterministic approach or even the KMC approach, right? As I told you, the weak link, the thermal desorption from physosorption sites, the strong one, R3, the recombination of two difference, R2 and R3, for example, the chemosorption via surface diffusion, and others which you can find at the paper that I mentioned before. For example, here in this paper, if you can go through it, you will understand more about the reactions at the surface. It's not really my area, so I don't want to take like a talk about it like I'm an expert. So I think this will be the main expertise need for Amber, because they have more experience in this area, and that's actually why we need Amber on this project. All right. So again, just again, the equations from the paper I showed you that are used in the deterministic model, and you can see it's a differential equations, function of reaction rates, different reaction rates. These reaction rates can be calculated, of course, based on, of course, on plasma chemistry model that coming from Plasimo or whatever, and we can solve for this thing. The good news, there's a researcher called Vasco. His paper is here again. If you want to go, maybe you'll need it to write your section in the proposal. Vasco developed an analytical solution of a single atomic species on a silica-like that can be, again, of course, extended to our project. Using nitrogen only, oxygen only, all right, on silica-like material. So again, this analytical model, it can be extended to model our plasma treatment on polymer, right? And it's an analytical model, all right? So it can be easily extended and used to program the DLNN, all right? So again, this asymptotic analytical solution as a function of the surface characteristics, the activation energies of the different elementary processes, like we discussed earlier, the densities of the adsorption sites, and the wall temperature, right? And that's why, as I mentioned a couple of minutes ago, that's why we need Amber on this project. So I'm suggesting, but of course you guys for sure, the guys at Amber will know better than me, if we are able to develop a DLNN that had better performance and solve the shortcomings of deterministic models, right? Yet, we can use the analytical solution to accelerate training. So it's like improved deterministic approach. That's one thing we can do, all right? This option, all right? The second option is the kinetic Monte Carlo KMC approach. And this will be very challenging. Why? Because I'm not sure, to be honest with you, when I look at the equations, I'm not sure how can we satisfy this physics constrained approach here when we talk about deterministic approach. Maybe you guys can, maybe you know better. That's what I think, all right? So KMC follows every particle and every site on the surface. The state of the system can be again described as the list of active sites in the simulation domain together with their occupancies, all right? So instead of simulating exact trajectories of all atoms in the system, in KMC, because it's Monte Carlo, right? It's Monte Carlo. Individual surface processes are treated as discrete jumps between successive states of the system. So it's different from molecular dynamics. Molecular dynamics will track the trajectory of each particle. This is not, right? It jumps between time to model the individual surface process, chemosorption, physiosorption, and this kind of equations will try to solve and simulate, but not different from the molecular dynamics. All right. But the problem, of course, of this simulation, it's very time consuming because the simulation have to deal with very large domains containing millions of active sites in combination with reactive rates spanning over many orders of magnitudes. This imposes, again, very high requirement, a very challenging requirement when it comes to computational limits. And I just mentioned two papers here from the same group of researchers. One discussed the comparison between deterministic and Monte Carlo, and the one focused mainly on the kinetic Monte Carlo modeling of plasma polymer treatment. All right, guys? But again, if we have DLNN to simulate this kinetic Monte Carlo KMC, of course, we will at least escape this computationally challenging thing. But before I say let's just first say the issues with KMC. All right? So again, the issues, again, is the requirement of the very challenging computational-wise. That's one thing. The other thing, it lacks truly predictive power because they rely on a large number of input parameters. All right? So missing or unknown parameters may lead to inaccurate model predictions. This is why benchmarking of KMC simulation against experimental data is essential. right? If we're able to have a DLN, NN, hopefully we can solve this at least three issues. We're able to overcome these three issues of using key KMC. All right, before I jump to the work packages, again, the good news here, this guy over here, Jory Kemari, he published a paper of developing neural network to model KMC, but different, not polymer, it's a copper surface diffusion. And again, the neural network is based on data training, not based on physics constraint, but it gives us hope, all right? So some guy already developed a neural network to simulate kinematic Monte Carlo, so it's not the first, but now we need to understand his model. How did he do it? Can we switch it to be physics constraint? Not to be dependent on training data, all right? So I mentioned here, this is Amber's decision to decide which DLN design will be based on deterministic analytical solution or based on KMC. Should we write, all right, we'll develop analytical deterministic and we're going to explore DLN for KMC because it's very challenging, really. Because again, when I look at the equations, I cannot understand how it's physics constrained. But again, it's your area, guys, and I'm sure you will know better. So we have three work packages. Work package number one at Syracuse University, they will develop DLNN for the plasma chemistry model. All right? While Amber developed DLNN for the polymer surface interactions. All right? Then the work package at Queen's University, we will, of course, couple the two codes, the code number one and code number two. That's one thing. But not only that, they investigate a novel DLNN architecture, all right? And also try to accelerate the DLNN using some kind of analytical solutions, for example. Different from the analytical solutions you will use, guys, on your DLNN of the polymer surface interactions. I have another ideas of developing different methodology, deriving analytical solutions of different equations. For example, the plasma chemistry model itself equations, which we should be able to drive semi-analytical solutions of at least a steady state even, that can help us to accelerate the DLN training. Also, I think we'll be able successful to develop different architecture from this one. From the standard neuron, just a group of layers of neurons that are connected through constants, and just to have to find the constant values through standard optimization routines on MATLAB or whatever. I think the architecture can be different, all right? And that will be one of the major focus of the work package at Queen's to try to come or develop new neural network architecture, all right? That may be more practical to simulate multi-physics process. As I mentioned earlier, this guy had an issue when he tried to train it to simulate Navier-Stokes. It took very long time to be trained, right? Yes, the analytical solutions I proposed, it will accelerate that. It can help with that. The analytical solutions that Amber will be using, it will help them to accelerate their DLNN code. But I'm looking past that, not only using analytical solutions to accelerate, but also what architecture, what can we do here to improve the neural network architecture design, all right? And of course, the digital twin, all right? So I say the three teams will collaborate to explore coding of the full DLNN multiphysics code on a chip, future extension, explore application impact on even additive manufacturing of composites, next proposal, all right? But of course, I mentioned in the next slide, I want to keep the digital twin mainly at Queen's University, all right? So for example, to make the work packages more balanced, so Syracuse, the plasma chemistry model. And then Dr. Wang, group research group, can use Placebo to guide them to validate them in DLNN development, all right? While the guys at Amber, right, developing the DLNN for the polymer surface interactions, and they can use the deterministic or KMC either, again, to validate plus experimental, which again can be used later at Queen's to once I couple both codes for code validation. And of course, as I mentioned, our main focus here to investigate the new architecture, DLNN architecture, and also the digital twin, the programming of the DLN on a chip, and hopefully we can produce or self-tune. Like I have a manufacturing equipment that can self-tune itself. Again, I don't think we're going to manufacture this in this project. We can only do it virtually, right? Virtually. But we can then propose an extension on or another proposal to do it in a real prototype, for example, right? But again, I'm leaving this up to you, and I would like to hear suggestions on that. I did not have my lunch yet, so I feel a little bit tired. But anyway, it's multi-physics DLNN chip, self-tuning, problem-solving, and automation. So thank you guys for collaborating with Queens on this project. And I can be available on Teams, of course, if you want to discuss any work package, you want to discuss the organization of work package, want to remove some task from here, put it there. I emailed you the example of an NSF funded project, so I hope you can write your work package very similar to his. Me and Dr. Wang will cover the other sections of the proposal. Hopefully, if we can get it by Christmas, then we have a draft to work on and improve before we submit by the end of February. All right. And also, we need to also to circulate this proposal also at Syracuse at selected professors there that can help us to improve the case submission. All right. So please, I'm available at Teams anytime. Just give me an email and we can arrange a meeting then. Thank you.